Okay, shalom. I apologize, I don't have a whole lot of time. I'm going to go over this as quickly as possible. Okay, Christ's humanity, the humanity of Christ. You know, Leviticus, it speaks of a sweet-smelling savior. Now, that smell that Jah is seeking is the smell of hard work, of sweat. Okay, when you sacrifice an animal, it don't smell very nice. It's the smell of sacrifice. So now, that being said, it's important that we note right here. Go ahead and take these notes down, pause it. I hope you can see it clearly. Now, the first up here, the second coming, Hebrews. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 9, verse 26. Very important to... Okay, and it reads... For then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed to men once to die, but after this the judgment. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and to them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin to salvation. Okay. Those that look for him, it's like we've done enough wrong. And anyone that happens to come across this video, listen, we've done enough wrong. And what we think that Jesus Christ, like if we were in such good standing that he's got to appear to us, you know, we owe it to him at least that smallest little sacrifice that we could do to look for him. You see, like, it's even those that say that the whole world would see him, those Christians out there, think about it. How can the whole world see Jesus? Even if he comes flying out of the sky. No. But we could see him in TV, and his name is His Imperial Majesty, Humanity-Haile, Sellasie. It's pretty clear. If you can't get over the fact that his skin shade is a little darker, then you got no business learning the business of His Majesty and His Christ, Jesus. Now, continuing, Matthew chapter 10, verse 41. I'm just going to summarize that. Those that seek a righteous man, you know, whoever seek a prophet will get a prophet's reward, but those who seek a righteous man's reward receive it a righteous reward. I mean, I apologize. Those that seek it, a righteous man receive a righteous man's reward. People are looking for floating aliens dressed up in blonde hair, blue eyes, or whatever, floating in the sky to say that it's the second coming. Or why don't you look for a good man? And it's not that hard because there ain't many. And you'll quickly come to understand that it's His Majesty. And it's not even that hard. He's the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah. If you go to Revelations chapter 5, verse 5, it's not that hard. You know, Christians, you know, I'm sure there's some of you that have some good. Try it, you know, try Him, try every spirit. But Him who claimeth that Jesus came in the flesh and He is the Son of God, He is of God. Now, holiness, total holiness. As I discussed on a previous vid, Matthew chapter 14, verse 23, when he goes up into the mountain to pray alone, Jesus did not fully, he did not fully commit to his disciples or any man because he knew what was in man. Now, holiness means completely separate. Totally separate. Now, Ethiopia. Throughout the Bible, Ethiopia is a form of holiness. Ethiopia was separated from the world to preserve the righteousness of our God and Father. It's that simple. Every time you hear mountains and the preservation of Jerusalem and, you know, the second Jerusalem, the new Jerusalem, it's Ethiopia. Okay, this isn't quantum physics or anything like that. So it's pretty simple. Go check it out. Now, physical. physical attributes of Jesus Christos, his imperial majesty, Jesus in his kingly character. Now let's go to Isaiah chapter 53. And it reads, oh, I apologize. Hold on one second. Okay, and it reads, "Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him." Okay? Now, note for all the Rastafari seeking discipleship and all that. This chapter 53, it pretty much, I'm not going to go into it right now, but it's all talking about the sacrifice of his Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie. So go ahead, and if you know your history, this chapter 53, Isaiah, is going to pretty much, you'll understand it clearly. Now, no form or comeliness that man should desire him. It's that simple. He's not a red carpet. Well, he is worthy of red carpet, but his Imperial Majesty and Jesus are not, you know, like, what do you call them? I guess like, they're not here to satisfy man's desire, rather to fulfill and do the Almighty Creator that is good, his will. Jesus came to testify to the Father. He didn't come here to look pretty. All right. So if you have a pretty looking idea of Jesus Christos, well, it's not. And there is beauty, but only certain people can see. I testify that I see beauty in His Majesty, but it's not the beauty that the world is looking for. Now, let's go to. Let's go to Luke. Chapter 19, and this is a little extra I'm gonna throw in there. You see, I'm gonna attempt to prove the size of Jesus Christos. He wasn't a tall man. If we go to Luke chapter 19, forgive me. Verse 4, and it reads, "And he ran before," this is talking about Zacchaeus. Now, "and he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him, and said to him, Zacchaeus, make haste, come down, for today I must abide at thy house." Now, a lot of people think that it's that Zacchaeus was the short one, and it could be. This is an opinion, but here's why I that the here's my proof. You see, if Jesus was a tall man, then Zacchaeus, even if he was short, he would have been able to see him. But no, in another scripture it says because of the press, right? And so there was a lot of people around Jesus. Now that's why he went up into the tree and he looked down, and Jesus looked up. That's another thing. If Jesus was taller, he wouldn't have needed to look up, because he would have been, well, not necessarily taller than everyone else, but he would have been able to just kind of like glimpse at him without having to overcome the everyone surrounding him. Now, another little detail is okay, I apologize. If you read from verse 3, it'll make a lot more sense. "And he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press, because he was of little stature." Now, I not that it's important, but, you know, just a little connection. Because of what I explained, I accept it to be that the small stature is being spoken of Jesus Christos. Now let's go to Exodus chapter 36, verse 14. Well, let me just I'll summarize this. We don't have a whole lot of time. Now, in Exodus chapter 36, verse 14 to 19, they're talking about the goat's hair and the badger's coat, skin on the tabernacle. Now, the badger skin, one interesting note is that it doesn't give a size because there's no form. And then the goat skin, goats were brown, but brown is black. I'll explain that right now. And I'm not going to go into it, but the beauty of the tabernacle was within. You have to be within Christ to see the beauty, like I said earlier. But as for the outside, it just would have looked like whatever, like ugly, pretty much ugly. But it's to throw off those evil, wicked people because that seek a pretty outside. Now, the goats, which is also symbolic of the soul, I believe, but let I not confuse even myself at this point. I gotta stick to the chart. Now, okay, I'll explain. We gotta go to Genesis chapter 30, verse 32, to explain the goats and how they were brown, meaning black. Okay, verse 32. Now, I will pass through all thy flock today, removing from thence all the speckled and spotted cattle and all the brown cattle among the sheep and the spotted and speckled among the goats. And of such shall be my hire. So basically they're all colored. And in this case, when it says brown, it means black. So the goats were black and some spotted, some striped, some speckled. Now that in itself is a very important teaching and old study, but I can't go into it right now, but I'll give you an idea. It has to do with why, well, it's way too long. I just wanted to use this verse to explain why the goat were brown and which is a covering of the tabernacle. So, you know, it could very well be interpreted as the covering of Jesus, you know. Well, it's obvious Jesus was an Afro-Shemite, so they're tough, you know. If you can't digest that, too bad. Now, so, well, he would be basically what people call black. So, let us go to Songs of Solomon, chapter 5. Give me 1 second. I'm not really familiar with the Song of Solomon, so... Okay, so chapter 5, verse, let's start, verse 11. His head is as the most fine gold, his locks are bushy and black as raven. So that clearly excludes a blonde-haired Jesus. And the whole Bible is testifying to Jesus Christ, so I don't care what you think that it's not talking about him. Well, the whole scripture is, why would it be any different here? And the locks, it has to do with the sheep, actually. I'll explain that. You see, in chapter 30, it goes into detail and it says that who was it? Jacob? Oh, I forgot. Give me 1 second, please. I think it was Isaac, but let me confirm that. No, my bad. It was Jacob. So Jacob gets all, Laban has been ripping off and burning Jacob. So Jacob gets kind of tired and he he says that all of the sheep and cattle and wool and goats that are spotted and black and brown, whatever, that will be his for his hire, and but that in time his righteousness will prove that they will be pure white and proven stolen, and there's a lot of detail, but it explains that he gets the sheep from the gutters, and that's to explain that their hair was curly and dark and locked. So that's a little interesting note to connect with the Song of Solomon's, and how his locks were black like a raven. So that cancels out a blonde-haired Jesus, right? Now let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 7 real quick. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 25. I hope I'm not... You know, I'm sorry I don't have time, but go ahead and pause the video. I hope you're understanding what I'm saying. Just, it's a little review to complement the holiness and separate to the Lord. To the Lord, studies. Now, it reads, "The graven images of their gods shall ye burn with fire. Thou shalt not desire the silver or gold that is on them, nor take it to thee, lest thou be snared therein." You see, silver and gold, it talks about pretty boys. You know, like, Jah is telling us that to throw away those gods, those little pretty looking gods, you know, that make him look, oh, he's so handsome, whatever. You know, Jah didn't send his only son, you know, to look pretty. He came to sacrifice and do hard work. Let's go to Leviticus chapter 2, verse 11. "No meat offering which ye shall bring to the Lord shall be made with leaven, for ye shall burn no leaven, nor any honey, in anything of the Lord made by fire. Honey speaks of natural sweetness." His Majesty and Jesus are not natural sweethearts, you know? They came to do the will and not to compromise. So, and then no leaven is because they didn't puff themselves up, okay? They're not here to look pretty and satisfy your curious eyes. You know, so they're forbidden. Leaven and honey are forbidden in when it comes to offerings of fire, I believe. Now, let me just explain this, or add this. Remember when they sent some Rastafari to His Majesty, and His Majesty said, nope, these aren't it. Next time, send the right people. You don't think a lot of Rastafaris got offended by that? But His Majesty don't care, you see. He's not here to satisfy our ignorance. He demands a certain type of people, and they were not it. So what? He speak the truth, you know. And a lot of people have problems with accepting His Majesty wholly on a few things that he might have done. But remember, he did what he had to do, you know. And that's to say that I and I is not to question whatever he did, because he came to fulfill the will, you know, and so of the Almighty Creator that is good. He didn't come here to compromise, so I'm sure he did some things that some people will not find soothing or you know, like or comforting, but you got to do what you got to do to fulfill the will. If you break hearts, whatever, so be it, you know. Now if we go to John chapter 7, verse 40, and it reads, "Many of the people thereof, when they heard this saying, said, of a truth, this is a prophet. And others said, this is the Christ. But some said, shall Christ come out of Galilee?" I'm going to stop right there. If that's all, you know, can anything good come out of Ethiopia? Can anything good come out of Jamaica? If you're going to base your whole, you know, so-called faith on that, well, enough said. some people are dumb enough to just base their whole make-believing on that. So just wanted to include that. Now, okay, logos, ignorance, and legality. Now, I'm going to jump over to like, there's, I was going to explain the attitudes because nobody liked them. Okay, they hated him. Well, let me just go into they hated him. They hated Christ so much. They hated him so much. They found him so disgusting and despicable and uncharming and totally opposite to what they wanted that they put him on a cross. They nailed him. They humiliated him. They beat him. They spit on him. They did all kinds of evil things to him. And they nailed him to the cross and they crucified him. I don't need to explain anything else. Totally separate to the Lord. That's the that's what we did to him. That's how much we hated him back then. But now, you know, eyefully, we come to love him. You know? So let's not take it personal if he comes back with an attitude, you know? You know, I'm joking. Well, I'm being sarcastic, but in a way, it needs to be said. John chapter 8. Let's go to John chapter 8. Well, actually, give me just 1 second, please. Okay. John chapter 8. Verse 3. And the scribes and the Pharisees brought to him a woman, well, I'm sorry, I didn't even explain. This has to do with the law. I'm just going to point out that logic, this is a logic wars. They're trying to catch them, the lawyers and the Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes, all of them. They're trying to trick them into saying something that they can condemn them, that they could, you know, to say a word to you know, to make a sentence. Well, to make the sentence stick. Now, and it also goes into the ignorance, which allowed for logical fallacies to creep within the legalities and condemn him. Now, okay, back to chapter 8, Gospel of John, verse 3, and the scribes and the Pharisees brought to him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they say to him, Master, Adonai, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what sayest thou? This they said, tempting him, you see, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground as though he heard them not. So when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said to them, He that is without sin among you, let him cast the first stone at her. And he stooped down again and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest even to the last. Now I'm going to stop right there. Okay, this kind of backfired on me a little bit because I overlooked the when he stoops down again. But I wanted to present this idea. If you go really quickly to Luke chapter 11, verse 20. It reads, But if I, with the finger of God, cast out devils, no doubt the kingdom of God is come upon you. So cast out, judge devils, liars. So with one finger, cast out devils and liars and pass judgment and discern and build the Jerusalem wall and by discerning thoughts and judging whether they be good or evil. And well, the nature of the thought. Now, with that being said, if you can recall, I didn't note it down. If you could recall Deuteronomy It's in the book of Deuteronomy, where it clearly says that God wrote the law with his finger. So the fact that it clearly expressed that he was writing on the ground, well, with his finger, made me think, okay, this has to do with the finger of God. So what was he? A lot of people wonder, what was he writing down? And then here's another clue or evidence. There's a point in the New Testament where they say, Master, good. They call him good. And Jesus says, Why dost thou callest I good? There is only one good. There is only one that is good. And who is good? God. Are you calling me God, basically? Now, that being said, that being established, that Jesus was good, and the only one that is good is God, so the Son of God being God, a God, you know, but don't misinterpret that. Now, so he's on good ground, basically. I'm trying to establish the fact that Jesus is good ground, and he's writing on the ground with his finger. And Old Testament reveals that God wrote the law with his finger, and the scripture in Luke reveals that if I cast out devils, liars, you know, and then know that the kingdom has come upon you. So put that all together. What is he writing first of all? A lot of people have thought different things, but I will say, and you know, you could think whatever, but I got good evidence. Well, this is all evidence to back it up. He was writing, thou shalt not commit adultery. Why? Because they caught her in the act and they brought her, but they didn't bring who was committing adultery with her. They did not bring a man. And when Jesus tells them, he that is free of sin, cast the first stone, they all left. Excuse my language, but the Pharisees, the Sadducees, they were banging her. They all left because they were convicted by their own conscience. They were sorry, and you know how these people do orgies and satanic rituals, then it's not hard to accept the fact that these hypocrites were, that's why it's hypocrites, they were banging her, you know, they were all doing her, but then they wanted to accuse her to get, you know, to tempt Jesus. He was either writing hypocrites, but I think he was writing, thou shalt not commit adultery, because that second verse where he stoops down again and keeps writing, that means he wrote a sentence, you know, and the fact that he went on as if he did not hear them also allows Fry and I to think that he kept on writing, so he wrote a lot. Maybe he even wrote the Ten Commandments, and I'm going to back that up also, because every time Jesus Christos comes into contact with the Pharisees, Sadducees, and all of those wicked men, Jesus Christos addresses the commandments, but they're breaking them. You see, thou shalt not have other gods. What do the Pharisees and all they tell? They tell Pilate. They tell him, we have no god but Caesar. They broke a commandment. Thou shalt not covet. They're constantly coveting Jesus. Thou shalt not steal. They're stealing from the people. When Jesus starts kicking the cash registers and all of that. And you guys make, you know, they're caught stealing. And they have the nerve to say, okay, he's acting out scripture and he's saying, and he's playing out scripture via vocalization as well. And then they have the nerve through their ignorance to ask, what sign does thou showest us? Like, they just saw he started doing what scripture said. It's like people can't put two and two together. It's really hard for them. Now, I got a little carried away with that, but it's important because every time there's an encounter with Pharisees, Sadducees, and scribes, they break a commandment. I had more examples. They kind of passed my head right now. Went over my head, but okay. We still got a little bit of time. Now, well, give me a second to recover. Maybe I'll remember some of the other... Thou shalt not lie. Thou shalt not bear false witness of your neighbor. And we'll get into that right now. Well, basically, every time the scribes open their mouth to kind of condemn someone, they themselves are breaking a commandment. And in this case, thou shalt not commit adultery, you hypocrites. They all left, you know? They all left. I guess I'll throw this in there. Well, no, I won't. Well, every time Jesus touches someone, it puts his hand on their head. It goes back to Leviticus because he's the lamb of, I mean the scapegoat. And then when people try to touch him and get saved, remember on the mount that Jah tells Moses that make sure that nobody passes the border because then they'll die. Now, I'm sorry, I shouldn't even said that. That's for another study. So let us continue by going to John chapter 2 real quick. Sorry, I'm apologize for being in a hurry, but that's what it is. Okay, John chapter 2 verse 14. It reads, "And found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and doves and the changers of money sitting. And when he had made a scourge of small cords, he drove them all out of the temple and the sheep and the..." Well, I'll stop right there. But, oh, well, I'll just mention this. It's in verse 16. "Make not my father's house an house of merchandise." Well, basically, that was evidence for that. And that's also evidence of the ignorance, because they ask them for a sign, like if they're not seeing what's going on. Just like His Majesty. Like, it's like, they want, I don't know what they want. They want to see Hollywood stuff and Disney miracles. They don't want to see truth, because then they get condemned. Now, which is something else I forgot to mention. They hated the fact that, they hated Christ's humanity. They hated the fact that he was a man. At one point, they even tell him, "You being a man, make yourself to be God." They hated that. They hated that. They wanted to see flying Mickey Mouse's floating in the sky dressed really nicely. And they wanted to see, I guess, any Hollywood things. But they wanted to see Beyonce-type figures, like, dressed in glamour and gold and silver. They wanted idols. They wanted to worship idols. And they could not accept the fact that Jesus Christos was a man, that he sweat, that he had sweat, which represents the fat in Leviticus. And that he worked hard and he walked and he wasn't dressed with the latest styles and fashions, and that he was humble. They wanted idols, basically. And it makes sense because, oh, and Jesus cried and Jesus and all of that, you know, and so if people that want those kinds of gods and idols, American idols, if like Superman, whatever, if they accept that Christ was a man, then that puts them in a position where they have to accept, and there is no way around it, they have to accept that now they are vulnerable and they have to live a certain way. Because if he, being a man, made himself God, well, then and you're a man too, that means you can do this too, which is another point. I asked myself, what is more impressive? Superman coming down with special powers and like a deity emanated, well, like man emanated from a deity, like a superhero coming down and then doing stuff with special powers, or His Imperial Majesty overcoming all odds through faith? What is more impressive? Ask yourselves, what is more impressive? You see, if it's Superman, then all we have to say is, well, he's Superman. You know, he could lift buildings. But His Majesty, being a man, proved that through faith all is possible. To me, that's more impressive. That's way more impressive than if some godly creature or whatever imagination comes down and gets to do all kinds of magic tricks. Cause, well, yeah, he's a cartoon. You could make a cartoon do whatever. But a man to do everything and overcome the worstest of odds through his faith, that is impressive. That is godly. That is divine right there. So just a little note. And now Luke chapter 20. Well, basically people want to be stupid. I'm sorry. I have to say people want to be made fun of. People want to be insulted. You know, they want to be taken advantage of. Basically, that's what's going on. People want to I can't explain it, but they want people to like cheat on them, basically, you know, like and pretend it's not going on. I don't know, people, it's weird, like they have the lowest self-esteem where they want to be played with, and they all know that these preachers and pastors are doing this, but somehow they love it and they enjoy it. They rather pretend. So, and that's I don't know what to think of that. I hope I'm not offending anyone. It's not my intention. In reality, I would like many to enter. Not that I've entered, but, you know, to at least try. Like, I'm trying. So. Okay, something is wrong here. No, I apologize. Okay, here we go. Let me see. Okay, I only have a few minutes left. Okay, I'm going to explain how it all went down real quick. The crucifixion and the ignorance and the logic wars. Okay, so chapter 22 of the Gospel of Luke, verse 70 would be, well, I'm going to start from verse 67. Art thou the Christ? Tell us. And he said to them, if I tell you, you will not believe. And if I also ask you, you will not answer me, nor let me go. Hereafter shall the Son of Man sit on the right hand of the power of God. Then said they all, art thou then the Son of God? And he said to them, ye say that I am. And they said, what need we any further witness? For we ourselves have heard of his own mouth. You see, this is bearing false witness. He never said anything. He said, you say that I am. And so the ignorant will be like, oh yeah, that's a logical fallacy. Like, all they did was kind of like mislead them. Oh, you heard him. He said that ye say, but people, when they're in crowds, they can't think right. Well, not even individually, let alone in crowds. So they go with the flows. You know, like, you should try it. Experiment. Get into a, well, I'm sure none of us want to, but you could get into a group of people and then lift your hands up in the air and start shouting and going like, woo! Everyone's going to start doing it and nobody's going to have the least bit idea or clue why they're even doing it. But they will do it, trust me. Go try it. People are that ridiculously controllable and manipulatable and easily hypnotized. Now, I'll continue chapter 23, verse 3. And Pilate asked them, now they send him to Pilate, saying, art thou the king of the Jews? And he answered him and said, thou sayest it. Then said Pilate to the chief priest and to the people, I find no fault in this man. You see, Pilate is not an idiot. He's educated. He's a ruler. And so when Jesus said that, he clearly understood that. I can't condemn him for that. He didn't admit. And so he finds no fault. And then interestingly enough, he finds out that he's under the jurisdiction of Herod, I believe it is, because he's a Galilean. And then Herod sends him back and so on and so forth. But I'd like to just end this by